Hello and welcome to this video where I'll summarize the standard IFRS 10 consolidated financial statements. I am Sylvia of cptbox.com, the place to be if you want to understand and apply international accounting rules easily. We help you to pass your exams, get your CPDs if you need, plus we have loads of other great stuff for professionals and students as well. You're welcome to check all out at cptbox.com. So IFRS 10 rules were a part of the standard IAS 27 since 2001, and at that time IAS 27 covered both separate and consolidated financial statements. And then there were a few changes in IAS 27, and a major revision and change took place in 2011 when IASB issued a new standard IFRS 10 dealing solely with consolidated financial statements. This standard applies from 2013 onwards. The objective of IFRS 10 is to establish the rules on how to prepare and present the consolidated financial statements when you control one or more entities. And in order to meet this objective, IFRS 10 first sets the requirement. So if you control one or more other entities, then you must present consolidated financial statements. There is other very clear video explaining all the terms available on this channel called Introduction to Consolidation and Group Accounts, so check that out. IFRS 10 also defines control, sets the whole guidance about it and how to determine whether there is control or there is not control. IFRS 10 also sets out the accounting requirements for the preparation of consolidated financial statements and outlines the procedures you need to follow. And also IFRS 10 defines an investment entity and sets out an exception to consolidating particular subsidiaries of investment entities. Let's take a look at control first. An investor controls an investee when it is exposed to or has rights to variable returns from its involvement with the investee, which will be a subsidiary in this case. And this basically means that you are not receiving a fixed return, such as coupon or preference dividend, but you can receive dividend from profits or nothing if subsidiary makes loss. Then an investor has the ability to affect those returns through its power over the investee. And the focus here is on power. And IFRS 10 defines it as the existing rights that give the current ability to direct the relevant activities of the investee. Relevant activities are those that substantively affect the investee's return and may include, for example, purchasing decisions, research and development, and so on. The existing rights must be substantive, so the holder must have the practical ability to exercise that right. The investor must have a current ability to exercise these rights and not some potential ability in the future. IFRS 10 suggests that more than one factor need to be considered, and also there is a whole guidance in IFRS 10 about the control, its existence and non-existence under various circumstances. Except for the control, IFRS 10 speaks about the consolidated financial statements, and these are defined as the financial statements of a group presented as those of a single economic entity. So basically, we take the separate financial statements of a parent, then the separate financial statements of a subsidiary, and based on these statements, we can make a group consolidated financial statements. And it means that you need to perform certain consolidation procedures, and they are not a simple addition of two numbers. All these procedures are prescribed by IFRS 10, and except for these procedures, IFRS 10 sets the accounting requirements that you must apply when making consolidated financial statements, for example, about uniform accounting policies, different reporting dates, inclusion and exclusion of subsidiary from consolidation, presentation of non-controlling interest, changes in ownership interest, and other. Again, you can all learn that on cptbox.com. Let me briefly describe the consolidation procedures required by IFRS 10. Step number one, combine like items of assets, liabilities, equity, income, expenses, and cash flows of the parent with those of its subsidiaries. And combine means simply add up. Step number two, we need to offset or eliminate carrying amount of parent's investment in a subsidiary with parent's portion of equity of each subsidiary. Step number three, offset or eliminate in full intragroup assets, liabilities, equity, income, expenses, and cash flows relating to transactions between companies in the group. Because from the point of view of external users to the group, there is no transaction. That's the basics, and there is a nice video with a simple Excel example illustrating these procedures on this channel, so check that out. Finally, let me brief you about IFRS 10 exception related to investment entities. IFRS 10 sets several exceptions or parents who do not need to present consolidated financial statements, and investment entities are one of them. So what is an investment entity? It's an entity that obtains funds or money from one or more investors for the purpose of providing those investors with investment management services. Its business purpose is to invest funds solely for returns from capital appreciation, investment income, or both. And it measures and evaluates the performance of substantially all of its investments on a fair value basis. IFRS 10 provides a guidance on how to determine whether the entity is investment entity or not, so you might need to check it in the specific circumstances. The main four characteristics that the company is an investment entity are that it has more than one investment. Then an investment entity might have more than one investor. It's not the condition, just the characteristics. And also it has investors that are not the related parties of an entity, well, other than having direct shares there. And finally, it has ownership interests in the form of equity or similar interests like shares and not debt. And these are just characteristics or indicators. And even if the opposite is true, the entity can still be classified as an investment entity. So you must assess each case individually. So that was a short summary of the standard IFRS 10 consolidated financial statements. It's not meant to be a full lecture, just a summary of the standard. And if you're interested in more detailed explanation of the group accounting, our case studies and examples teaching you how to prepare consolidated financial statements, then check out cpdbox.com, subscribe to our free newsletter, subscribe to this channel, and please feel free to share this information with your friends who might benefit from it. Bye-bye, and thanks for watching.